Did you know that there are fraction rules that we teach kids that actually expire? Yeah, there's things that we teach them that work for right now, but they don't work long term. I'm Christina Tondevold, the Recovering Traditionalist, and I hope you'll stick around as we explore fraction rules that expire in our quest to build our math minds so we can build the math minds of our students. Now, we're not just talking about rules and procedures that we teach kids around fractions. We're also talking about language that we use that expires or should expire because it doesn't build true understanding for kiddos. So these things all come from one of my favorite articles called 13 Rules That Expire. And don't forget, the links are always right below this video. But that article really opened my mind to a lot of things that I was telling my students that don't serve them long term. So the first one we're going to take a look at is, all of these actually are around fractions, but this first one is about the idea that when we have fractions that are greater than one, we should always write them as a mixed number. Like, that's a rule that we tend to tell kids. If it's a fraction that's greater than one, you need to rewrite it as a mixed number. That's not always the case. Like, yes, they can be written as a mixed number, but there's often times where it is beneficial to leave that fraction as a fraction greater than one, right? Like, let's say they're doing a problem and they come up with an answer to part of the problem that is 17 eighths. Well, if they transfer that into the mixed number of 2 1/8, but then the next part of the problem has them subtracting 3/8, that makes it even more difficult to solve the next part of the problem, which instead, if they had just left it as 17 eighths and then went to subtract 3/8, super quick to do that problem. And then if they need to at the very end, yes, you can put it as a mixed number to figure out what that value is. But there's often times where you do not need to be turning those fractions that are greater than one into mixed numbers. And as kids get into the upper grades, a lot of the work that they do that involve fractions greater than one, like dealing with slope, it is always left as a fraction or a fraction greater than one instead of transferring it into a mixed number. Now, the rest of these are all, I guess, language that we use when we talk about fractions that might not necessarily expire, but they need to expire from our vocabulary because it's doing a disservice to our students in building their understanding around fractions. And the first one is a little bit of a pet peeve of mine because I was so stinking guilty of doing it. I still catch myself saying these words, that when I'm talking about a fraction, I use the phrase out of. It's really hard for me to not say it, but it's become a pet peeve of mine because I know the power of not saying it. Okay? When we say out of, like for the example, 2/3, if I say that as 2 out of 3, it's a ratio view of fractions, which is more complex version of fractions, and it also makes kids think that it's two separate things, right? 2 out of 3, instead of seeing it as 2/3. It is one number. A fraction is one number. We also need to be saying that one number with the attribute that it attaches to. I don't know if that's the right word there, but basically we need to put it in context, people, because fractions only make sense if they are in a contextual situation. 2/3, I need to know what it's of. Is it 2/3 of a cup? Is it 2/3 of a gallon? Is it 2/3 of $1 million? Those are very different things. And so when we say a fractional amount, it's not just 2 out of 3, it's 2/3 of something, and we need to attach that of something to the fractional amount for those fractions to truly make sense. Now, one of my favorite variations of how we should be saying fractions is attaching the unit that we're working in. So with that example, 2/3, we can say just 2/3, But if we kind of break it apart a little bit and say the number and the unit fraction as kind of two pieces that come together, it builds such powerful understanding for kids. So instead of just two-thirds, often it's helpful to say two one-thirds. Slight variation in how we say it, but man, it makes a big difference for kids to understand that two-thirds is two one-thirds of whatever you're doing, right? I could have two one-thirds of a cup or two one-thirds of $1 million, right? Whatever it is. But it helps them see that I've got to figure out, to know what two-thirds is, you've got to know what that unit fraction is of one-third, and then we get two of those, right? It's such a powerful way to talk about fractions, and it's way better than saying out of. Okay, the next one is to stop saying the phrase reduce. Yes, right? I'll say all of these are ones that I have been guilty of. So if you are still saying it, don't feel bad, right? We do the best we can with the knowledge we have at the time. And once we learn better, we do better. So one of the things I want to encourage you to do is to do better when we're talking about equivalent fractions. We're not making them bigger. We're not making them smaller. We're not reducing, because that's what that phrase reducing makes us think about, is that it's getting smaller. And that's not the case. We need kids to understand that all we're doing is simplifying. I like that phrase so much better, because that's really what we're doing. When you see 5/10, we aren't reducing it to a half. It's still the same, but we're simplifying 5/10 and writing it as a half, because a half is a simpler fraction to operate with, to think about and be able to visualize than 5/10. So the idea of simplifying fractions creates this better imagery for students than reducing does. Now, on a side note of this one, all too often, every single problem we give students that involve fractions, once they get their answer, the textbook, the worksheet, whatever, says solve, then simplify. Why? Why do they need to simplify every single answer? The only reason in real life that we ever simplify a fraction is if we're then going to go on and use it to operate a little bit deeper with the problem. I want kids to understand when it's appropriate to simplify a fraction and when it's okay to just leave it. Right? If all I'm doing is operating and I added and all I need is my answer, that's fine, right? That's all they need. But oftentimes we need to simplify if we're going to go on and use that answer to help solve another part of a problem. So my advice is, don't make kids simplify just for the sake of simplifying. Teach them to understand that you simplify maybe because you want to connect it to a simpler fraction, or we simplify because we need to then use that fraction and then do some more operations with it. And it's easier if we simplify that fraction to begin with before we move on to do more operations. Okay, our last one is to stop saying top number and bottom number. I was so guilty of this. It's still hard. If you watched the video a few weeks ago that Graham Fletcher did, he even said it in his video. He was talking about top and bottom number. It is so easy for us to just say that instead of saying numerator, denominator, right? Top and bottom is easier to say. And it tells the kids which number is which. Numerator, denominator, we have to explain all of that stuff, right? It's so much easier and it works super quick to just tell top and bottom. But it does a disservice to our students because it facilitates that understanding, or misunderstanding, I should say, that a fraction is two different numbers. When we say the top number and bottom number, they see it as two separate numbers that we're just putting together and separating with a line. We want them to understand that a fraction is one number. Two-thirds is one number on a number line. It's not a two and a three, right? So it's a simple thing to change, but it really is very powerful in what it builds for our students' understandings around fractions. All right, I hope that this one helped you build your math mind so that you can build the math minds of your students. Have a great day.